मेरी मैम, गुड इवनिंग टू ईच एंड एवरी वन। आई सेल्फ प्रणव जैन, सेक्रेटरी ट्रिवेंद्रम चैप्टर। वी आर हियर फॉर द फाइनल प्रोग्राम ऑफ आवर पोस्ट ऑडिट प्रैक्टिकल फाइलिंग सी प्रैक्टिकल एस्पेक्ट सीरियस विच इज लेड बाय आवर मोस्ट एमिनेंट फैकल्टी सीएमएटीआर बालचंद्र सर। आई होप यू हैव ऑलरेडी एंजॉयड टू ऑफ हिज स्पेक्टेकुलर सेशंस। सो बिफोर वी स्टार्ट, वी शैल स्टार्ट विद आवर इंस्टीट्यूट। Dear respected members, this has been the third program in our cost audit practical series, and we have already completed our income tax filing series, which is led by CMABM Thomas. And today we are into our final program of our cost audit series practical session by our most eminent faculty CMATR Balachandran sir. Previously we have covered the methodology of the cost audit and the cost audit of sector specific cost audit classes we already covered, and very happy to announce you to inform you that after completing this practical session we will be coming with a practical filing series of ROC, which is scheduled on next week, which is scheduled to be start by next week, and which is to be inaugurated by our honorable center council member CMS Patnaban on 16th. All the communication regarding that will be shared to you very shortly. So without taking much of time, I am going directly to the faculty. Over to you, sir.
Good evening to all. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to interact with the members and students about cost audit. So as I have told earlier, this is the final session. During the last two sessions, we have covered the first session. We covered the legal part of the cost audit mechanism. In second session, we covered some of the practical aspects, and today we will be coming with more of the practical aspects of cost audit mechanism, as well as the details about filing the report. So I will share the presentation first. Is it seen by all? Hello,
sir. I'm making it live, sir.
Yeah. I hope the presentation is on the screen.
Yes, sir.
Presentation is on the screen, no?
Yes, sir. You can start, sir.
Yeah. And I am audible, I hope.
Yes, sir.
So once again, thank you so much. So today we will go in detail about the audit process and filing of the report. So I will just, since there has been some gap between these two sessions, especially last week it was scheduled, but I could not attend because of a very important meeting with one of our clients. We had a meeting on the same day scheduled regarding the cost audit itself with the board of directors of the company. so I couldn't attend that. So that's why it got shifted. So it's almost, I think, 3 weeks since the last session was over. So I will just take you through a very, very quick update, quick recap on what we have discussed in the first two sessions. So first session, we discussed about the cost audit framework. So what is the cost audit framework? It starts with Section 140 of the Companies Act, wherein the maintenance of cost records and cost audit is mandated. And then under Section 148, rules have been formed. Rules means there has been a series of rules starting from 2014. The 2013 Act actually amended the cost audit provisions, and that's how Section 148 came into being. Before that, it was Section 256. So now under Section 148, rules have been notified starting in 2014 itself. So 2014 to 19, there has been a series of notifications. Finally, a consolidated notification was issued in 2014, which is applicable now. Then the institute from their side, so the rule itself says that the cost records have to be maintained in line with cost accounting standards and generally accepted cost accounting principles. So institute has notified cost accounting standards. There are 24 cost accounting standards. Generally accepted cost accounting principles have been notified. So the records have to be maintained in line with these. Then there is a note. There is a review mechanism. How the audit has to be conducted. There is a cost auditing and assurance standards board. So they have also issued various standards for auditing. About 19 standards are there. Other guidance notes are there. So an auditor, a cost auditor, has to necessarily go through all these things, because at any point of time, if there is a clarity required in any of the applicable provisions or applicable audit rules, he can refer back to this. Then there is a quality review board, QRB, which actually takes care of the quality of the work done by the various cost accountants and cost auditors. So that's very important. That actually is very important from the point of view of the cost auditors. Then the final thing is filing of report in XBRL. So this is the full mechanism. We have covered about 70-75% of the mechanism up to QRB. And today we will go more into the practical aspects, because I am not a theoretician, I have repeatedly told. So we will discuss the practical aspects of cost audit. Further into last session, we covered some of the aspects. So this session we will cover more of the practical aspects and the filing of the report part. So this is, I'm just taking you through the last session. Last session we discussed about the audit process. What are the pre-audit checklists? So knowing the industry, knowing the company, knowing the competition, what are the products, then planning for audit, how to plan for the audit, what are the things that you should understand about the company, about the business they are into. Then understanding the annual report of the company, which is very, very important, because you are starting from the annual report. You have to go deep into the annual report, including the director's report and the auditor's report, because in each of the reports, there will be some mention of something, some happenings or some accounting policy, which is relevant to your audit also. That is why you have to completely go through the annual report, including all the notes. Then further to that, you have to go deep, have a deep insight into the cost levels and variations, because between the years, what has been the variations of major element of cost? Why? Because when you compile the cost sheet, you might find that in some particular cost element, suddenly the cost has risen over the last year. So what is the reason? So to understand that, you need to have an understanding of the cost levels. Then an auditor has also to understand the CAASB guidelines and CASs, precisely because when you conduct the audit, you have to have everything in line with the CASs. Then on the practical side, allocation, apportionment, absorption, we have discussed some portions. Then cost audit report and annexures, we have covered the report portion completely in the last session. And annexures to report also we have completed. In the sense, we have had a peripheral view, because of course, one has to really go through the whole thing again and again, and really cost audit being such a mechanism, you have to probably go through the exercise 3 or 4 or 5 times, then only you will understand the gamut of the operation. Unlike a financial audit, wherever they go, whichever industry they go, whichever company they go, they have the same set of rules. You have the standard format of profit and loss account, notes, balance sheet, or if they are into taxation, the tax law is there, tax audit, there is a format. Unlike financial audit, we have a much more difficult task, because whichever industry you go, the practices are different. The process industry varies from a job order type of costing or a batch type of costing. And whenever you go to a different industry, and in different industry, when you go to different companies, their practices are different. The cost auditor has to in-depth understand the industry as well as the company in detail. Then this session, we'll have audit of cost statements and directions we will discuss. And cost accounting policy and cost audit report, we have discussed a few portions. I hope the presentation is visible now. Hello.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Sir, it's visible, sir. Oh, visible.
Right. Thank you. I will take forward. Now we have covered certain things about the allocation, apportionment, absorption of expenses. I will take another 5-10 minutes more to go deep into this, because some members had already requested to cover the practical session also, the practical part of the allocation also, to cover some more into it. So we have already seen, we will start with expenses classification. This is actually a big challenge in some of the industries. Why? Because the booking pattern varies from company to company, and for cost auditor to complete his process, he has to have a cost center level of expenditure booking. So sometimes it becomes a big challenge in some of the industries when you find that expenses are not booked properly. Then I have seen even some of the cost auditors, without properly classifying the expenditure, they will go for the easy option of dividing everything by the quantity produced, or maybe take a percentage of the revenue. That is not the idea of cost audit. Cost auditor has to definitely analyze the expenditure and allocate the expenditure to the concerned cost center, apportion the expenditure based on some scientific basis, and absorb the cost to the relevant product or relevant group of products. Then there are challenges in ERP and non-ERP environment. You know, in ERP environment, there is a structured format of capturing the cost. Cost center, profit centers are defined, cost centers are defined. So the cost will be captured in the cost center, and profit center level margins or profitability is available. But still there are challenges. We will have a detailed discussion on that later. We have already discussed some portion. Then identification of direct cost elements. So this is the most important part in our audit exercise. The direct cost elements have to be properly classified. The direct cost elements, direct material, direct labor, and direct cost. So direct material, of course, most of the companies have no trouble in identifying, because they are daily tracking it. In process industry, we'll go by the total consumption of materials. In an electronic industry, for example, we'll go by the bill of material of the product. And the rate of materials, of course, there are some companies where they follow a batch level costing. What I mean is that they actually have a bill of material, and every month they will load the cost, raw material cost, to the bill of material, and month end they will find out the cost of the product based on the bill of material. And there the ERP software will have a facility to aggregate the batch level cost for the year. There are some companies like that. There are some companies where they follow a standard costing system. The batch level costs are captured based on standard cost, and variances are captured in a separate ledger heads. So you have to go to the batch level cost of each of the product, then aggregate it on an yearly basis, absorb the variance also to the product level. Of course, it's not easy to have this done manually. These are all to be done by the software. So most of the companies have such facility. Otherwise, it's the duty of it is for the cost auditor to take up the matter with company and get it done. Then direct labor, you have to properly classify the direct labor. Then direct costs, what are the direct costs involved? You have to understand direct cost means costs which are, for example, job work charges. This is a direct cost. this type of course you have to classify under direct course. Then you have to also understand the gamut of direct material costs. In various types of industries, direct material costs are captured differently. We have already discussed some in the last session. So process costing, process industry, how it is captured, batch industry, batch processing, how it is captured, job order industry, how it is captured, construction industry, how costs are captured, service segments. Service segments means ports, airports, health sector. These are all service segments. So how to capture the direct material cost? There are also direct material. For example, in a hospital, the consumables or the hospital supplies which is consumed for the patients are a direct cost element. Of course, they charge it. That will come under the revenue side. Then how to apportion joint cost? In mostly in process industries, you will come across joint cost. Take the case of a petroleum refinery or a chemical industry where you will see that the first process is after the first or second process, two or three type of products are produced jointly. So you have to have a clear understanding of what are the basis on which you will apportion the joint cost, whether it is on quantity, whether it is on value, or whether it is on cost before split off. All these you have to decide. There will be a practice by the industry. So you will have to accept that practice, or you will have to suggest a new practice which is more feasible and which is more scientific. Then byproducts. In mostly in process industries, there is an incidence of byproducts also. So byproduct cost, how will you absorb? Which is the main product? Theoretically, you have to identify the byproduct. The byproduct realization has to be identified. The direct cost incurred in byproduct, further processing after the incidence of byproduct, of the generation of byproduct, you have to identify. Then you have to arrive at the margins of the byproduct and give credit of the byproduct realization, net of cost, to the main product. That's a challenge. In health sector, we have already discussed. Then what are the challenges in apportionment? The standard costing system, we have already discussed. I have seen only one industry where standard costing system is practiced in detail. What, it's a multinational company. Most of the multinationals have a standard costing system. What they do is they will fix all the element of cost down to the level of each ledger level in the year beginning. They will have a sales forecast. Based on the sales forecast, they will split it into production forecast for the whole year, and then the bill of material will be frozen. The material cost, material rates will be frozen. Then each of the element of cost, wages, salaries, power, all other, even line item wise expenditure will be frozen. So what they do is, there is a batch processing, batch cost processing system. What they do is, every production order, it will go through the whole process. Then once the material after production moves to the finished goods store, there is a production order closing mechanism. Once they close the production order, automatically all costs will hit the ledger heads on standard cost, and then the actual cost will be booked. And all the variances will pop up. So the variances will be either price variance based on the real purchase price versus the standard price, or it will be efficiency variance, the man hours and machine hours, that's also defined. It will be there. So, or the usage variance. So this is theoretically one of some of the best companies, multinational companies practices, which is very difficult because they have a challenge. What they say is, this client which we have, they always say that their major botheration is explaining the variances to the top management, because there is a monthly review by 3rd or 4th of every month where the management sitting in US discusses only the variances. So variances have to be properly explained. It's a wonderful system. So now our challenge is to capture the cost, because we are supposed to capture the cost of each of the product. So there is a system, the system will pop up the variances also to the product level, and the variances are captured, variances and the standard costs are captured to the product level. Then expenses classification. So sometimes you can either have a general, for example, salaries. salaries, under salaries, there will be 10 or 15 expenditure heads. Salaries means salaries of staff, salaries of officers, then leave salary, like that, lot of heads will be there. Either you can pull up the expenditure, or you can, if some expenditure level head is actually very large, for example, overtime. Overtime is very large. It's not ideal to apportion the overtime to any department based on the total salary. So you'll have to probably identify the incidence of overtime in the concerned section, so that you allocate that overtime to that particular section itself. Of course, staff welfare is an item where you cannot have any segregation, because staff welfare will have best subsidy will be there, canteen expenditure will be there. All these you will have to pull up and maybe apportion to the production department and service department based on probably the salaries and wages of the department. So expenditure head level apportionment, you will have to have logic. The direct cost, nature and treatment. Direct cost, we have already explained, job work charges is a direct cost. Or some other direct cost element, for example, mining cess in a mining industry, that's a direct cost. These are all items, of course, that will be classified separately in the cost sheet. Direct costs have to be classified, and you'll have to probably have a strategy of how to absorb it in the product. There, for example, job work charges, there will be one ledger head. How will you absorb it to the product? So ideally, you'll have to go for the contract rate. So there will be a most of the companies have a general contract rate for job work for the year. You take the contract charge, the agreed contract rate for the year, with the quantity you can arrive at the cost, applicable cost to be allocated to each of the product. Still, there could be some minor variation which you will have to absorb as variance. Then utility cost. Utility cost means power, fuel, steam. All these things you will have to have separate heads. Heads in the sense, you will have to have a separate capturing of each of these costs separately. For example, under utility, you will have the KCB charges will be there, the diesel generation charges will be there, the salary of the substation people will be there, then other general loads will be there. All these have to be calculated separately and absorbed. Then depreciation. Depreciation mostly you will go by the fixed asset schedule itself. So from the fixed asset schedule, you will have to analyze the direct depreciation. Whatever is shown as depreciation in the cost sheet is the depreciation of the machines that produces the product. So other depreciation, like depreciation of buildings, depreciation on your office equipment, these are all mostly classified in the either production overhead or administration overhead. So you will have to analyze the fixed asset schedule and classify the depreciation to each element. So I will show you a sample head, sample working in the coming slides. Then production overhead and general overhead, you will have to classify it, and you will have to arrive at a mechanism for absorbing the production overhead, whether it is on labor hours, whether it is on machine hours, it can be on labor, a combination of labor hours and machine hours, it can be a combination of cycle time multiplied by the quantity produced. It varies from industry to industry. In some industry, it can be on quantity, because, for example, in a process industry, for example, let's say three products are produced. So identically, three products which have probably more or less the same economic value, you can probably absorb on the basis of the quantity. Then selling overhead, how to absorb selling overhead. Mostly selling overheads are absorbed based on sales realization, but of course you can decide to have, you can classify it into three. One is selling overhead related to domestic, then selling overhead related to export you can classify, and common selling overhead you can classify. That's the best scientific method of classifying a selling overhead, because in most of the industries there will be exports, there will be domestic sale, there will be some common overhead, for example, rent of a warehouse. That's a common overhead. Or rent of a building, for example, their sales office. That's a common overhead. That's not for domestic, that's not for export, it is for both. Then administration overhead. We have already explained, pure administration overhead is the head office overhead solely. Whatever is incurred at the factory related to administration in nature, for example, postage, stationery, telephone expenses, these are all incurred in head office and factory, but whatever expenditure is incurred in factory is classified as part of the production overhead. But whatever expenditure incurred in head office or for general supervision of the company or secretarial expenditure, finance department, like that, or head office rent, These are all to be classified under administration overhead and absorbed separate on the basis of maybe sales realization or some other basis. Then export versus domestic, you have already mentioned this has to be separately classified so that you calculate the profitability or margin of export and domestic products separately. We have already discussed that ERP and non-ERP environment, there are a lot of challenges. We have already seen that ERP, most of the ERPs have provision for profit center and cost center level booking, especially SAP is, SAP can be manipulated to the extent of a product. That much of facility is there. Some of the local ERPs or some of the even other ERPs have anyway profit center, cost center mapping will be there. So that actually is the basis for capturing the cost of each of the cost center or each of the product center. So cost center, but what are the challenges? Sometimes the cost center hierarchy may not be suitably defined, keeping in view cost audit requirement, because normally all the businesses keep have a segment view. For example, let's say an industry having, let's say, five manufacturing centers. The general perception of the financial auditor or the financial person is to have a unit level profitability. Beyond that, he will not think. So unit level, everything will be booked under different ledger heads. But for your exercise, you will have to again classify the expenditure into direct wages, power, fuel, utility cost, manufacturing overhead. So the cost center hierarchy may not be suitably defined in line with your requirement. So that is an exercise which you will have to probably do one time and maybe convince the management that probably next year onwards your booking can change in line with our requirement also. But there are challenges. Some of the companies will accept, some of the companies may not accept, because that may involve some cost, because any change in SAP, unless it is supported by their own people, if you are going back to the consultant who implemented SAP, it is costly, they will charge. So cost auditor need to go from ledger head to cost center level, maybe the first time to understand the pattern of booking. The first time when you are doing an audit, you go to the ledger head and understand what is getting booked in that expenditure. Only then you will understand how to classify the expenditure. We already discussed, you can suggest changes in cost center mapping. Mostly there will be some resistance from the management side if cost is involved, resistance from the staff side if more job is involved. Then there are challenges in SAP also. For example, once you implement an SAP, we have seen in one company very recently, last 5 years, we have been telling them that cost center mapping is not appropriate, because they have actually grown in the last 5 years from a single, they have expanded operation, they have grown, they have created a lot of verticals, but then the cost center mapping, cost center level hierarchy remained the same. The last 5 years, we have been in our report, we have been mentioning that the cost center mapping need to be reviewed, and maybe you will have to have it in line with the change scenario now. But then they have not been, because not that there are not enough people to manage that, but then they have not probably given them the right importance. But then this time we have become successful. This time actually the managing director got upset. He said, I want a due date within which you have to give me a commitment that you will have a review of the whole thing. And we have also been given a task next December. He said, half yearly profit I want to see in the change scenario. We have actually seen the challenge is, if cost center is not properly mapped, we will have to go down to the level of each expenditure, analyze the expenditure, and maybe map the expenditure to the profit center and cost center. Then only you can complete the exercise. This all, I mean, in a more scientific way. You see, remember, we have to certify unit level and product level cost and margin. That is why you will have to go deep into each of the expenditure levels, analyze the expenditure, classify it properly under the various cost elements, classify it properly so that the cost is absorbed to the right product in the right level. So it's our duty to ensure that cost is captured accurately. Then ERP we have discussed. Then non-ERP, even in non-ERP, we have found that the locally made ERP, some companies, they have the system of cost center hierarchy. So some systems are robust enough to have product level cost center information. We have seen that also. Then in some cases in non-ERP Non-ERP means we have only, there are certain companies where with even with growth 150 200 crores level they still use Tally. But then Tally ERP version has facilities, but then most of the companies do not do that. Then your option is to only go to the ledger level analysis. But then it is, and some, there are, we have seen a company very recently, there we don't, we have, there is no classification stores and spares. So when we ask, they are saying that stores actually gets booked under repairs, which is not the ideal. So we suggested that you should have an account by name stores and spares, so that that expenditure is tracked separately. So practices vary from, what I'm saying is that practices vary from industries to industry, practices vary from company to company within the industry. So whenever you do an audit, based on your experience, your exposure, it's for you to point out the changes that are required in the booking process so that your job becomes easier next year. Then in some cases, apportionment also is a challenge. Because we have seen one of the cases, we have seen that it's a company which is producing pipes. So the most ideal way to apportion the cost is based on the cycle time of manufacturing, because the manufacturing is a simple process. There are only three stages. One is mixing, then extrusion, then curing. These three are the only stages. So what differentiates the products is the cycle time. Cycle time means extrusion time will be different, curing time will be different. But this company does not have that. So we have suggested that you should have this a scientific study done on this. So I will take you through a sample apportionment file, which it's a very large file. So I will show you some peripheral level of that file. This is actually, I think if I remember correctly, it will be about 90 or 100 columns. So I will take you just to understand how it is being done. This is our way of doing. There is no standard way of doing. What we do is we actually have a single file from the P&L down or rather trial balance level to the annexure. We have a single file so that any change made in any of the stages, the change is captured instantly there up to the level of annexure. That's why we have a single file. But there are certain experts in the field. I know I cannot name them because experts in the field who actually have made Excel-based program where every year they only input the required data to the concerned column and you will get the entire thing in a flash because that much of programming, but then that's an advanced Excel level of programming. What I will show you is a simple Excel with the linkages. I will take it now. Can you see this? Hello, can you see this?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yeah. See, this is a sampled allocation apportionment sheet.
Like
so where column C, actually, you will see the ledger, process material, raw material. This is strictly taken from the P&L notes, P&L notes and trial balance. Of course, you will have to depend on both. The first column, C column, details each of the ledger heads, packing material consumption, job work charges, then coming down salaries and wages, contribution to profit fund. Like that, it goes and goes, and finally, overheads, we have classified overheads and other expenses under which rates and taxes, postage and telephone, printing and stationery. So finally, all the ledger items will be mapped here. Why we are doing it is, this is to ensure that finally the profit as per P&L is matching with our working also, because you will have to take each element of cost. Unless you do this, unless you have a scientific method of classifying the expenditure and have an apportionment allocation sheet, finally your reconciliation will become a challenge. That is why ensure that, I mean, this is only our method. You can have multiple methods. Now, so this actually, unit one, plant one. Plant one, plant two, there are separate sheets. Now, plant one, process material. So this is classified under, there are three sections. Fabrication, plating, assembly, tool room. These are the four production centers. So this is classified under plating. Now the second is raw material consumption, fabrication, because it's actually about 800-900 items are there. We have just put it there, but there are separate workings for classification. Now salaries and wages. This is salaries and wages. We have put under fabrication this much, plating this much, assembly this much, tool room this much. I have not taken the link. So this particular expenditure in, let's say, for row E17 will have a linkage where you will find out the details of the workings of the salaries and wages. Either it would be probably the annual salaries and wages they themselves are given for the unit, for the particular section, or probably you will work it out on the basis of, let's say, 1 month sample salary. So that you can go to the linkage. So this particular sheet, this particular expenditure is, will have a back linkage. Like that, each of the expenditure, if you see, there will be a link to the supporting sheet. So that is how you classify each of the expenditure. Now this is plan one. Then these are other general overheads, factory overhead, administration overhead will classify. So each of the expenditure will have a linkage. See, column D, it links to D12. Interest, non-operating income, trading, there is a separate question there. Now when you go here, plan two, similar classification is done. So this is a typical allocation. See, this company had about, I think, 6 or 7 units. That is why there are about columns up to CM. I've just shown it because if you follow this type of a method, by one side you start with all the expenditure items in the ledger, then you go and apportion or allocate it to the various plants, to the various cost centers, and then finally you see difference, there is a column. So if at all there is any difference to the ledger, that will pop up here. So that if there is any issue in your allocation or apportionment, automatically that will come up here so that you can correct it then and there. Then the next stage is absorption. Absorption means at the absorption level, you will classify, you will have each of the product codes, then production quantity. This is actually the cost sheet for each of the unit. So the absorption will be, if you see, cycle time, the basis of absorption is cycle time into quantity, cycle time into production. Then RM cost, raw material cost actually has come from the previous sheet, allocation sheet. All the expenditure in this sheet, the absorption sheet, will come from the previous sheet. That is how you work out cost of production and margin. See, this extends to work in process, cost of production, cost per unit, opening stock adjustment. Then finally you go to sales domestic, sales export, sales total, then sales value, adjusted value sales, export entitlements, total revenue and margin. So this actually extends to column BB, where product level margins are worked out. So in this way, if you follow, it will be easier for you to reconcile profit. Otherwise, if you have standalone Excels for doing the cost audit of, let's say, 5 or 6 units, finally you will land up in a lot of trouble because reconciling will be a challenge. So back to the presentation. This is visible. Hello, the presentation is visible on the screen?
Yeah. Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay. Now I am reconfirming, so that last time it happened, so happened that it was not visible for some time.
Today there was no technical challenges, sir.
Now this up to this we had actually discussed last week. Some portion were to be completed, so I completed that session 2. Now session 3, this is the agenda for the session 3. Annexures. Now we will go to annexures. Annexures we have already seen. We have seen in the last session itself. And there are 12 annexures are there. There are part A, part B, part C, part D. Part D is mostly the financial ratios, then value addition, related party. Part A is general information, and the part B is about the cost sheet and all. So what are the key things that you should keep in mind while auditing the annexures? Then key points for, then we will discuss further on audit of manufacturing industry and audit of service industry. There are differences in these two segments because manufacturing industry audit is always a big challenge. Service industry, I am not saying that it is not a challenge, but the challenges are low. But service industry, will when we discuss about service industry, we will have more insight into the service industry specific problems or specific issues of service industry. Then management report on audit and findings. This is a very important area which is actually becoming very visible now, because earlier scenario, most of the management, most of the companies were concentrating on financial audit, the net outcome. Now there are certain companies where we are auditing, we have in a focused manner, we have also started giving some insights into their cost level, some insights into their margin levels, product level margin, and we have a couple of companies who insist on a presentation of our findings to the board of directors. That we will touch upon some of the key issues, key areas that we can present, we can highlight to the management after this exercise. Then we will discuss about filing the report and XBRL. What are the issues or what are the problems that you might encounter when filing an XBRL report? This is about our agenda for the remaining part of the day. Now, I have touched upon some of the annexures to highlight some of the issues that or some of the points that you have to keep in mind while preparing the annexures or auditing the annexures. So product service details, there is, I think it is a third annexure after the general information. It's the third annexure. After the general information, cost accounting policy is the fourth. Part A is the fourth one. So product service details, here you have to give data for each product segment under audit or otherwise, because that it actually has about five columns. I forgot to add, I could have shown that here, but then due to the lack of time, I don't want to show it again. Last week we have shown there, it actually asks for the classification of the products, whether cost audit is the unit of measurement, second column, whether audit is applicable or not, you will have to mention yes or no. That means you will have to show both, whether even if cost audit is applicable, you have to mention yes. If it is not applicable, you have to mention no. Then you will have to give last year the revenue or the total revenue of the product segment last year, product and current year. So this information is to be given for each product segment level, like each CTA level information has to be given. It is not you have to give the entire information for all the products separately, CTA level product, and that too you have to give information on audited products and unaudited products also. So this, when you give, you have to ensure that the total realization given is matching with the realization as per the P&L. And then there is a line item, other income. Other income, it has to be exactly in line with all operational incomes. You have to classify either way, but other income, other general income, like interest income or income from rent, income from other services, this other income extra, and then there is another line item, exceptional extraordinary income, then comprehensive income. These all have to be straightly taken from the P&L. Why I am saying is, otherwise if you don't take it, sometimes there could, when you are filing the report in XBRL, there could be validation errors. So other income, exceptional or extraordinary income, and other comprehensive income all have to be as per P&L. Then capacity information. Capacity is in part A itself, capacity, there is a requirement of giving the information on your production, how much was your production last year, how much is your capacity, what is the capacity utilization, and then your opening stock, closing stock, and after adjustment of opening and closing stock, how much is the sold quantity, and how much you have sold in domestic market, how much you have sold in export market. This is a total annexure summary. So this information ensure that this is based on company certification, because capacity is something which company has to certify, and also ensure that if there is an increase in capacity during the year, if it has happened during the year, then you will have to probably give a weighted average capacity for the whole year. For example, a company is having, let's say it's having a 10 million production capacity, And during the year, let's say from October 1st, it increased the capacity to 15 million. So that means 5 million capacity is added. But then when you are comparing the actual production, you will have to probably give 10 million as the capacity, installed capacity. Capacity enhanced during the year, you can wisely give 2.5 million, because it was enhanced from October. So half year only it is applicable, so that the comparison of the installed the capacity utilization percentage is more realistic. So definitely this is to be based on company certification. After the audit is over, you will have to get a management representation on the capacity and enhancement during the year. Then quantity of production, opening stock, closing stock, sales, etc. as per quantity reconciliation statement and cost statement. So here you are also giving the quantity of production, opening stock, closing stock, sales, everything, all information is here. But ensure that in the coming sheet, after this, immediately you are going to the cost sheet. So this sheet should definitely tie up with the coming sheets of cost statement, because cost statement also on top, there is the quantity of produced, opening stock, closing stock, quantity sold is there. So ensure that the information of quantity given in the quantity, the capacity sheet is the same and tallying with the information given in the cost statement. Otherwise, if there is a mismatch, when you file the report, there will be a problem. Then cost statement has to be made for each product, just in the previous this thing, I have shown an Excel in which there are about, I have shown you the second sheet which I showed was actually a cost statement for each of the product, but then that's about 800 line items. Those 800 are not to be given, each individual cost sheet is not to be given. You have to only give cost sheet at CTA level. The 800 cost sheets are actually only 2 or 3 CTA, customs tariff codes are there. So you will have to give the cost sheet at aggregate the cost of all the products and show it. The cost sheet will be shown for each of the CTA level product. Probably there will be only 2 or 3 cost sheets. Yeah. Then industry specific operating expense. There is, if you see the standard cost sheet which is given the rules, there is one line item, industry specific operating expenses. So this is a very specific item in respect of certain industry. So do not go by, if you find that in the certain specific expenditure, do not classify it there. This is actually meant for special type of industries, specific industries like telecom sector. Telecom sector, there is an item by name revenue share. Revenue share is an expenditure for the telecom sector. Each telecom operator like Bharti Airtel or Idea Vodafone, they are actually giving 6% of the revenue to the government as a revenue share. This is a cost to them. So the revenue share can come under specific operating expenses. In mining industry, mining CESS is paid. This is a specific industry level expenditure. You can classify those expenditure under industry specific operating expenses. Then value addition, if you see, unfortunately we don't have time. Value addition is a very important sheet, which is actually in the last part D of the annexures. It actually shows how much is the value added. Value addition is actually your gross realization, including export entitlements, minus the direct cost elements like direct material, stock adjustment, then power and fuel, stores and spares, and other bought out items. So other bought out items will mean, so you will classify all the items, all the items. So other bought out items will mean all the other expenditure other than you, whatever is there in the line items, minus your non cost items and finance charges and depreciation. That's the classification for other bought out items. Then there is a beautiful document, which is released by Institute, and it is available in the MCA site as well as in our PD portal. It's called Architecture Training and Guidance Manual for Filing of Cost Audit Report in XBRL format. It's a very lengthy document, about 100-120 pages are there. But it you can refer to this document for any clarity required on the annexures. Page, if I remember correctly, I think I have written it also somewhere. Page 40 to 84 in that document will give para-wise all the annexures. It will give line item-wise explanation of what you are supposed to be filling, supposed to fill up in that particular place. So that much of information is available. Actually, it is equally useful to the students also, because students, if there is any clarity required, any type of expenditure, any type of any item in the annexure, you can refer to this document. It will explain what details are to be captured and how it was to be captured. Then, which we have already discussed, key points in the audit, suggest the company to have a single Excel file, because this single Excel file with all the links to the cost statement from P until expense allocation, apportionment, everything has to be in a single file, so that when you finalize the audit, you will find that, okay, this expenditure is to be classified separately. If you go back to the file, if you make a change, that change should reflect in all the files, including the annexure. Otherwise, it will be a very, very difficult process. If you have standalone files, you make a correction there, and you will have to go back to the annexure, make a correction there. Then the report portion, you will have mentioned something, you will have to make a correction there, which is laborious and cumbersome, and you might commit mistakes also. Then ensure each ledger that we have already discussed this portion. Then check the after completing the allocation apportionment, this check the allocation apportionment figures with the previous year variation. This is very important, because once you complete the allocation apportionment, check the allocation apportionment with previous year allocation apportionment file. If you are doing the audit, if somebody else is doing it, you have no choice but to do it in the most scientific way that you can imagine. There could be variations, but you will have to explain it. So if you are doing the audit, you should go back to the previous year file and check the mode of allocation apportionment, or rather the actual figures of last year versus this year. If there is any wide variation in the figures, either some of the expenditure levels has gone up substantially, or you have committed some mistake. This is the first point to check by an auditor, because if there is a mistake, you correct it then and there itself, because after completing the annexures also, you need not go back to the whole thing. Then we'll touch upon some of the most important part of auditing the annexures. Verify the unit cost and average cost statement for any major variations in the previous year. Because in cost sheet, the most important thing is analyzing the cost, because how will you analyze? There is total cost of each product is there, each group of product is there, and unit cost of each product is there, and current year cost is there, previous year cost is there. So the first thing that you should that should catch your eye is the unit level cost. How much has been the direct cost material, direct material cost last year versus this year per unit? So if you find that there is an increase of, let's say, 30%, so you'll go back to the raw material prices. Raw material, you'll have to check with the company why there is so much of a variation. Probably you will find that one particular material had the imported material had the cost had gone up substantially, and it constitutes, let's say, 60% of the product. So you understand that there is a genuine reason for the variation. That aspect you will have to mention as a footnote in the cost statement also, because if you see the rules speaks of it very clearly. Says under the rules, if you see the footnotes of under the rules, it will very clearly say, in case of any major variation with the previous year, the auditor has to give explanation for variation. So or you'll find that, let's say, another aspect, direct wages, you'll find that normally 5 to 10% variance happens every year, but you in one particular year you find that there is a substantial variation, let's say 30% variation, which is very, very abnormal. Either there has been recruitment of more manpower in anticipation of an expansion project, or there has been a long-term settlement which concluded last year, enhancing the salary of all the people. So whatever may be the reason, you will have to analyze. Because when you analyze, what I'm saying is, when you analyze the per unit cost of each of the heads in the cost statement, the average cost statement, it will pop up issues, it will pop up mistakes, it will pop up the reason for variances, which you will have to very clearly mention under the cost statement. Then verify that part A4, that is revenue statement, part D2, T2 is reconciliation statement where you will reconcile your profit with the profit as per financial books. The as per financial books has to be as per the P&L. Then D4 and D5, that is value addition and financial ratios. All these are actually, you take most of the data from the P&L account, because somewhere something of the P&L account and balance sheet comes to ensure that the figures are reconciled with audited financial records. This you have to ensure. Then stock valuation as per cost records. You might recall that I have mentioned the last session also. The stock valuation financial books is done as per AS2, which talks about cost or market value, whichever is lower. So how do they find out the cost? Normally when financial audit is conducted, what they do is they will take the latest cost of raw material and work out the cost of raw material as of March of every year. Then they will allocate, absorb the overhead, the factory level overheads on based on some basis. Maybe it is weight, maybe it is raw material for some basis, and other costs they apportion on some basis. They do not do a large extended exercise that like that we do. So definitely, and some of the expenditure which they take may not be taken by us, which will appear as a non-cost item with regard to the statement. So what do we do? So definitely there will be variation in stock valuation between financial books and cost books. This actually gets reflected in the reconciliation statement. But ensure that if there is any major variation, that's an issue. So you need to ensure that if there is a major variation in stock valuation, either some of the cost elements that you have taken have been wrong, or the stock valuation by the financial audit has also wrong. So whatever may be the reason, if you are wrong, you will have to correct it. You will have to go back to the allocation sheet. You will have to go to the apportionment sheet. You will have to go back to the cost statement. Then probably you will find that the financial auditor has taken the last March cost. Whereas, for example, in a batch processing industry, you will actually take the bill of material and take the weighted average cost for the whole year. If the weighted average widely varies with the March cost, then there could be an issue. But then you will have to analyze the reasons and convince the management. Then we have already discussed footnotes on major variations that are to be given in the annexure. Then thoroughly check the reconciliation statement. The reconciliation statement is a gold mine for hiding even the mistakes. That you have to ensure that each line item in the reconciliation statement is checked thoroughly. What are the non-cost items taken? What are the non-revenue items taken in the reconciliation statement? Then the stock valuation variation, everything has to be analyzed so that to ensure that nothing is hidden by the client, because normally people won't do it if unless there is, but then some small amounts could be there which you can ignore. But then if there are wide variations, wide errors, mistakes, then you will have to find out and probably they will have to correct the cost statement. Value addition financial ratio figures are to be in line with auditor figures, which you already discussed. Financial ratios, major variations are to be explained with footnotes. Financial ratios, it is shown some of the annual accounts, you will find that directors report also reports some of the ratios. So check with those ratios also, because you cannot report a figure in variance with that. But then there could be some minor variation, because in capital employed, you are probably taking the weighted average capital employed for the whole year. But then whatever may be the variation, for example, you'll find that the working capital ratio this year versus last, there is a wide variation. Or the stock turnover ratio, there is a wide variation. So you need to give an explanation on why it is there. I can cite an example in one of our industry, in one of our client. Always there is a problem because the year-end stock ratios will widely vary. Why? Because it is their industry is a very industry of a seasonal nature. So what they do is they will procure the raw material from, let's say, starting from July to February, and they keep it in stock. That is kept in stock on 31st of March. The processing happens after March, because the procurement period is 6 months prior to the financial year, and the manufacturing period is mostly 6 months next to the financial year. So always there will be a very heavy stock. So sometimes you will find that if the value of the stock is high, you will find that turnover ratio, when you take based on the last audit, last day of the year, there is wide variation, but then this can be explained saying that it's a seasonal variation. Then related party and indirect tax. Related party and indirect tax mostly. Related party, of course, you will go by the accounting standard disclosure which is made in the annual accounts, notes on annual accounts. You will go by the same figure and probably an indirect tax also based on GST return. So you will have to probably take a view. I mean, that's what we are doing, saying that this is as per the auditor records or this is as per the GST records, and we are not conducting a detailed audit because we cannot be expected to have a detailed audit of these figures. Related party certified by the financial auditor will go by the figure. Indirect tax is based on the GST returns, will go by the figure, but then give a footnote. Then check back with CASS in case of any clarity on treatment of any expenses. That is when you finalize the apportionment and allocation. If at all there is any doubt about any of the treatment of expenditure, you can go to the concerned cost accounting standard. Then suitable management representation has to be obtained wherever required, which we already discussed, capacity. Then certain expenditure, major expenditure, we very recently come across an item where their R&D expenditure, suddenly I found that the R&D expenditure is substantially higher than last year, and it actually, when it hit the profitability of one particular product segment group, they went into red. But then officially they are saying that we had a profit. So we had a lengthy discussion, and finally we found that even these people didn't know. The R&D group was a global R&D group. Of course, these people knew that they were doing a lot of service for the global operation. So that much of cost which is incurred for the global operations was segregated, and we are showing it under reconciliation statement. So for this we are taking a management representation. So this management representation has to be obtained for major variations in expenditure or for capacity or for any of such items. Then cost accounting policy, this is to be jointly drafted with the client. The client will mostly be very, very familiar with drafting the accounting policy because it is a standard one, it has been carried over from years together. But then cost accounting policy is something which the client would not have thought of any time. But then there is a standard format for drafting the cost accounting policy. Under each of this, you will have to sit with the client and write it for the first time. But then do not think that this is sacrosanct. This is not a stable one. Every year probably you will change something because the cost accounting policy asks for apportionment allocation methods or policy. So probably next year, this year you will have been done on some policy. Next year actually you will find that most of the expenditure is classified down to the level of cost center. So you can take it directly. So the policy, necessary changes have to be made in the policy, in the disclosure. So don't think that this once it is drafted, it is stable. So every year you'll have to go through the whole thing again, and any changes you'll have to incorporate in the next year also. Then we will briefly touch upon the challenges in manufacturing sector and service sector separately. What is the manufacturing sector? If I can recall my exposure of last 39 years, personally I feel that the years which I worked in the manufacturing sector has been the most challenging. But then of course, when you work for 10 years in a system, you will feel that it is monotonous. But then when you come out of manufacturing, you will find that manufacturing gives lot of challenges day-to-day basis. Because the information flow that you are supposed to control, the MIS requirement that you are supposed to project to the management, the updation in knowledge that you have to make to be in line with the changes in the accounting practices, these are all very, very challenging. In service sector, why I'm saying is, it's not that it's not challenging, the challenges are different. The manufacturing sector, you will be updated on the professional front. In service sector, what the major problem is, if you take most of the service industries, they are operating on a pan-India or a global basis. For example, if you take an insurance company operates on a pan-India basis. And if you are, let's say, finance fund of a state, you will be exposed to the problems in the state. You will not be exposed to any of the accounting challenges that they are facing in the corporate office, any of the other challenges in the product pricing, all these things, unless you are also posted to the head office. So why I'm saying is, I have had the opportunity and I have been fortunate that I worked with manufacturing company and the service industry for 9 years, manufacturing about 14 years, with a consultancy, project consultancy organization for 4.5 years. That is by exposure. Then cost audit for the last 10 years. So with all these things, I can tell you that manufacturing sector has given the right perspective on starting a consultancy, because that gives a lot of challenges. Then only when I got shifted to the head office of the telecom company in which I was working in Mumbai, that I came to know that the process of costing is applicable even there also in a similar way to our what we practice in manufacturing company. There, if you see each of the product, there actually the product is for a telecom company, the product is a prepaid plans or the postpaid plan. So each of the prepaid and postpaid plans, there is a standard cost sheet in which they convert the cost into airtime cost, the revenue share, the landing fee, whatever, maybe lot of costs are there, and then finally arrive at the cost of per minute, cost or cost per second, and then they find compare it with the revenue. So that but then when you're working in a service industry in a state, you will not be exposed to any such challenges. Whereas manufacturing, etc., in a location, you are the master, you have to go through various challenges. So when you are auditing a manufacturing sector, knowing the process of manufacturing is very, very, very important. You will have to go through the process, you will have to visit the factory repeatedly to understand the process, because you need to have in-depth knowledge of the process, because you are classifying the cost based on the process. Then knowing the product portfolio, you need to understand what the product is, what type of products are there, what are the applications of the product, what are the variations of the product. For example, we have a client which produces relays. You can find a relay as small as your thumb, the tip of the thumb, to as high as maybe 2-3 square feet of a product. So you need to understand the product variations. Then you will have to understand the capacity of each plant, because in manufacturing companies you will find that there are multiple plants for the same company. So you will have to understand the capacity of each plant. You will have to understand how that plant operates, because RM inflow of all the units may not be ideal. We have a client where two units have all the processes. There are three or four processes, two units have all the processes. Other three units are only assembly units. So only when we did the audit of these companies, we found that. So you'll have to understand the capacity of each plant and the RM inflow and all of them, because we found that the in-process raw material supplied by one plant to all the units. We had a challenge, because when we compiled the cost for the first year, we found that the cost of product in plant one, which is the mother plant, is very high compared to the cost of product in other plant. Because the raw material cost book in that plant we have taken. But we found that this company also had a practice, the inter-unit transfers of raw materials were not debited or credited to the RM consumption account. It was passed through the inter-unit account. So we had to actually go to the inter-unit account, take out the RM consumption, then finally arrive at the consumption of each plant. So RM inflow of all units or our expenditure, then the sales expenditure, because sales may be centralized in one place, but then certain expenditure related to sales are incurred and maybe booked at head office. You need to understand all these things. Then RM consumption norms, you need to understand very clearly what are the consumption norms, especially in a process industry. You need to understand how much is the yield. For we have a client which produces phenol. So the yield of at stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, you'll need to understand what are the wastages that are happening, what are the invisible loss that is happening in the process, and how the bill of material is built up, because the bill of material will have to take care of the normal scrap as well as the abnormal scrap, normal scrap as well as the invisible scrap. Then when you build up these things, you will find that there is a variance, RM variance, because when you compile the cost of product based on the bill of material and the weighted average, or the last raw material price, we'll find that that raw RM consumption is not matching with the P&L RM consumption. So there will be variance. The variance can be, let's say, 3 to 5% maximum. 5% itself is very high. So if there is a major variance, somewhere something has gone wrong. So frequency of specification changes. Why I'm saying is the specification of each product is very, very, see, when you go by the BOM, the spec, if there are very frequent changes, you will have to change that specification which has run for maximum part of the year. Then how batch costing is done by the system? Is it done by the system independently, finally? If there is a facility for aggregating the cost, then job order industry batch. Hello? Is there anything? I saw some sound. I heard some sound. Am I audible? Hello?
Audible, sir. Audible. Okay.
Fine. Thank you. So RM rates, how it is built up in the system, whether the freight element, inward freight has been taken, how about the tax credit? These are all things which you should review in the first year. Maybe year after year, there won't be change in the accounting practice. In process industry, we already discussed there is an incidence of byproducts and joint products. Then we will run through because otherwise I may not be able to finish. So cost apportionment, joint cost, what should be the basis that you have to adopt? Then technical norms of process loss or yield. So when you are doing an audit of a process industry, definitely the costing will be also based on technical norms for each of the product. For example, let's say in a common process, they will say that 36% of this product will come, 40% of this product will come, and the third product will be the remaining. So that technical normally we can adopt because there is no visibility on the RM contributing each of the product. So you'll have to go by that. Then stage-wise cost compilation. In some of the industries, we can, for example, this process industry, especially stage-wise cost compilation is possible. We have a client which is a process industry. There are three stages. We capture the cost in stage one, pass on the cost to the next stage. Then the second stage to third stage, actually, there is a split up between two products. So joint costs are apportioned. Then norms for utilities. What are the consumption norms for utilities? Most of the process industries, consumption norms are for each of the products are defined. Then invisible loss scenario, you have to understand. Then standard build-up material and frequency changes, which I already discussed. Then that is for for job order or batch processing industry, the build-up material is the Bible. You have to understand the build-up material, how frequently they are changing. Then raw material rates, what raw material rates you will take? We will take weighted average rate for the whole year for computation. Then technical norms for process loss. Has the bill of material built up the allowance for scrap and for this and the process norms that you need to understand, and compilation of variances, because once you combine the RM consumption based on bill of material and raw material cost, it will not match with the final P&L consumption figure. So adjustment of the variances have to be given. Then mode of compiling utility cost, you have already discussed. Mode of packing and related cost, because packing, there are two elements in most of the batch processing industry. There is primary packing and secondary packing. Primary packing is part of the cost of production. Secondary packing is part of the cost of sales. So you have to segregate, and there in most of the products, if you see the multiple product scenario, for example, in electronics industry, packing norms are there for primary packing. So you will have to apportion the cost based on the packing norm. And at secondary packing, of course, That too, there could be packing now, which you have to adopt. Then depreciation, amortization, impairment cost, we have already discussed. That depreciation revaluation. In some companies, periodically they do a revaluation of the assets. Maybe 10-year, 15-year gap, they do revaluation. But then the impact of revaluation, we will not absorb into cost. The impact of revaluation, we will eliminate, and that much of depreciation on revaluation will reflect in the record statement. Then wages and salaries, classification, allocation, apportionment, manufacturing industry, we have already seen the sheet also. Stock adjustment issues, stock adjustment, the major problem is in some of the companies, the earlier, if you remember in Companies Act 1956, in the notes itself, there was a requirement for disclosing the opening stock, production, sales and closing stock. That was mandatory. So those days it was easier for us to capture this because this was compiled on some basis. We would have the backup data. But then now this disclosure requirement is not there. Stock adjustment in some companies, there is a major issue, especially in multiple product scenario when 800,000, 5,000 products are there. But then unless it is electronically done, it's very difficult to reconcile this. Then production overhead, then common basis for apportionment of expenses. What are the basis for apportionment of expenses? Overhead apportionment challenges, we have already discussed. Service department cost. Service department means the utility cost. Utility cost, you will have to actually, in your apportionment sheet, you will have to have a separate cost center for power, fuel and all these, steam, and you will have to apportion the cost of KCB power under KCB, DGZ, then the salaries, then stores and spares of generating room, whatever it may be. All these will have to be pulled up. Service department cost has to be apportioned to the product based on it, either based on technical norms or by either based on consumption norms. Then R&D and technical know-how, most of the companies, they classify it separately. Then finished goods stock adjustment, we have already seen the issues, relevance and issues. We have already seen that there could be, if there is any wide variation with the financial books, that of course has to be probed in detail and necessary corrections have to be done. Then traded goods, treatment in cost. See, trading goods, some of the companies, in some companies, the traded goods will be very small. But then there are some companies who actually do lot of trading. In the sense, maybe 20% of their revenue is through trading the goods which they produce itself. They buy from outside and they do only repack it and sell it under their label. Mostly it is done either through their own sources elsewhere in the world or through some other sources. So you'll have to ideally have a separate cost sheet for traded goods. But then when it comes to the cost sheet disclosure part, the concerned CTA, if you see the cost sheet itself, there is a line item, quantity purchased, quantity of finished goods purchased, there is a separate line item in the cost statement. We have to include that, the trade cost of the traded goods under that and for disclosure. Then administration order and selling and order interest, we have already discussed how to absorb it in the cost. Issues when company has multiple products and some are not covered under cost audit. This is a challenge because if the company has multiple products and some are not covered under cost audit, necessarily you have no choice but you will have to work out the cost of each of the product and classify whatever is your product, you will have to disclose it under cost statement. Others remaining, you will have to show the net margin under margin under the reconciliation statement. The reconciliation of profits in financial books, you already discussed. Comparison of the previous year, we already discussed. Explaining reason for large variation cost levels between years. And that has to be shown as a footnote under each of the annexures. Then standard costing system, we already discussed. Then service sector. Service sector, the major challenge is identifying the service segments. For example, I don't know, some of the people would be exposed to audits in hospitals. What is the service segment in a hospital? Ideally, the service segment in a hospital is each of the department, that is service, because each department is unique. The gynecology is a separate department, cardiology is a separate department, cardiothoracic surgery is a separate department, anesthesia is a common department. So, but then for disclosure purposes, our institute has also published a very beautiful document on health sector costing. So we are going by that. IP and OP are our service segment. But the challenge in service segment is the company does not book expenditure into IP and OP level. Of course, they have most of the health sector companies have booking of revenue stream wise. They will revenue, but then expenditure is not really booked. Because lab actually gives support to OP and IP, how to segregate the cost. In some companies, we find that they have a separate identification for OP and IP, but then some companies it is not. So you will have to, these are the challenges in service segment. Then airport. what are the service sector in airport. Airport, of course, what is the product? Suddenly, when we are doing audit for an airport, so the domestic and international are the airport segment. We capture the cost into domestic and international, but then the company also should have similar system in their ERP mapping. Then telecom, what is the product? Telecom, of course, you can have the prepaid and postpaid as a product segment. Banking, broadcasting industry. We have done an audit of a broadcasting industry, a news channel. So first, when we went there, they also were surprised. He said it is applicable, and then finally they appointed us. So finally, we took almost 2 days to understand the industry and arrive at a logic for the segment. Finally, we narrowed on to what is their product. Their product is airtime. They sell airtime. Their revenue is only advertisement revenue. So we classified their airtime into domestic export, and there was one more segment. I forgot the name of the segment. It is actually, if you see, for half an hour slot, for 1 hour slot, suddenly, if you, especially in the nights, you will see that one advertisement is given for half an hour, one particular that stream. I forgot that also is third segment. So we identified and classified expenditure. I found out the prepared a cost sheet. Then cost compilation, segment level booking is mostly not there in some of the service segments, because we have discussed, for example, the broadcasting industry, they don't book expenditure for domestic and export separately, or they don't know how much is the expenditure on domestic segment, on export segment separately, except that they may be having an overseas office, that expenditure is booked separately. But then the cost part, you will have to have a real, how to apportion the cost, you will have to have a logic. I think if I remember correctly, we apportioned the cost based on the airtime spent, because the broadcasting time. Then lack of awareness by the concerned staff, because in service industry, they are quite aware of the financial audit requirement or the financial booking requirement. But this is a novelty to them, even some of the companies. Then convincing management sometimes is a difficult process, because management will say, why should I do it? But then once or twice when you do it and show it to them, they are really, most of the managements are really interested. And collection of the base data is a challenge in some of the industries. Classification of expense challenge in some of the service segments. These are all the challenges in service segment. Then industry specific expenses we have already disclosed. For example, telecom, there is the revenue share is an industry specific expense. Defining capacity is a challenge in service sector, because for them, they may not be very much interested in defending. For example, if you ask the hospital about capacity IP, there is a capacity, number of beds or the bed days is a capacity, but OP capacity cannot be defined. So you have to arrive at the logic for finding out the capacity, or you will not disclose the capacity and you have put not. Then there will be some segments not covered by the cost audit. In some of the, for example, a hospital running a nursing college is not covered under cost audit. But then you will have to identify the cost of the nursing college. You will have to also do the margins of the nursing college, because when you classify the expenditure, automatically this will pop up. Then what are the advantages of the service industry? No incidence of stock adjustment, no material reconciliation, no bill of material, no detailed process study, because the operations are simple. In a hospital, the patient comes, you are giving a service either as an outpatient or an inpatient. Consumption materials are there. Then nursing cost is there, then doctor cost is there. It's a simple exercise. You will finally collect the bill. So there is no such complication as a manufacturing industry. It's an advantage. But we have found that the information that we give is highly useful to the management. OP level profitability, IP level profitability. Very recently, we have concluded, last week I told you, because of that only we had to postpone this session. We presented a report to the management, to the board of directors. So we presented the IP level and OP level margins, and the hospital level margin is split into lab, hospital, and other segments, other investigation. We found that the margins that they make from the hospital is very meager, whereas they make the maximum profit in lab. This was an eye opener to the management. normally this is not analyzed in the management meetings. In their board meetings, they analyze, or quarterly meetings, they review the profitability on an overall level. This is not analyzed. So this is highly useful. In a service industry, actually, the scope for a cost auditor or a first for a cost accountant is substantial if they properly do the job. Then management report. Management report, I will quickly go through it. In the management report, I mean the in-depth analysis of the management's the cost audit. For large corporates, it is not relevant because they are already doing it on a daily basis, on a monthly basis. I have worked with large corporates, so that's why I'm saying there is a very detailed review of cost center or profit center level margins. Medium corporates, of course, they have utility. Then SMEs, actually, if you find SMEs, if there are cost audits, the importance of cost audit findings are very, very large because they do not have a proper, most of the SMEs do not have a proper costing system. You can add lot of value. You can add a lot of value like capacity cost. What are the costs involved and what are the costs in weighing the capacity? The contribution analysis you can give. The job work, the company is giving job work. What is your in-house cost versus job work cost? In one industry, we have found that the outside processing cost was rather more than the in-house cost. So they actually changed next year, next contract period, they actually amended the cost for the job work. Then product margins, we can highlight the product level margins to SMEs. And expenses variance. Some of the expenses, when it keeps incurring, management does it because in the monthly or the quarterly reviews, profitability is projected, but then down to the level of expenses variance are not analyzed. This is cost audit is an opportunity for you to project that. Then trend in expenses versus revenue over past 3 years. How the fixed cost has grown over the last 3 years in line with the revenue. Has it grown more than proportionate to the revenue? If it is grown more than proportionate to the revenue, it's a challenge to the management. The inter-firm comparison, of course, you like to do a lot of digging of internet to understand which are their competition, what are the competition in India, what are the global digits, what are the cost levels you can present to the management. Segment level and unit level margins we have already discussed. Then there was a performance level appraisal report in 2011 rules, which was there, which we used to show it also, but unfortunately in 2014 rules, it was taken off. But you have an opportunity, even if the management doesn't show interest, you are at freedom to send a performance report to the management subsequent to the audit. Then you can also show global trends in the industry and global cost level. Then suggestions for improving accounting and costing process that you can always give. How the cost center mapping, how it can vary, remapping of the cost center, these are all things which you can add value to the cost audit. Then identification of low margin verticals. We have one service industry where we have done, they have a vertical which has been incurring cash flows year on year. We have been highlighting it, and this year, last year, they have actually gone to a new revenue stream. They have made a marginal profit. These are the value additions, all the value additions that you have given in your exercise. Then we will quickly run through the XBRL reporting format, but then of course we don't have much time. I will quickly run through XBRL. What is XBRL? Extensible Business Reporting Language. It's a universally accepted preferred language for transmitting information. It's an open international standard for digital business reporting. The reporting is made digitally. Earlier in my younger days, when we were doing the cost audit, we had to send 5 copies of the cost audit to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. It was each cost audit report was about 400 pages. So we used to take 5 copies, means it's a big bundle. We used to send it and it used to go there. It used to be dumped somewhere in the corner, and some department somewhere wanted, they used to take it. But then now it is filed digitally. The government has access to all the data. Government compiles the data of all the various segments, all the various industries, where the various companies that is under cost audit, they have all the data. The XBRL provides a common electronic format for business reporting. It does not change what is being reported. It only changes how it is reported. It is reported in electronic form. Earlier it was manual form. So electronic reporting enables easier manipulation of data by the users to the report, because uses the report. Our first order report is only the government and various governments of departments of government. They can actually manipulate the data the way they want. MCA has mandated filing of cost life information pursuant to cost audit record rules in XBRL language. So benefits easier preparation, analysis and communication of information. It provides cost saving because you need not take a printout, you need not take bind it, you need not send it there. And even for them also, if they want to analyze it, you will have to have long, lengthy hours. Now it is all available digitally, electronically. It improves your efficiency also. And it actually, there is a better reliability of data. Because earlier scenario, all the companies were having audit and all the companies were doing audit and sending it in manual form. But then you never know whether this company has a practice, this company is reporting and the other company is reporting, there are wide variations. So you never, I mean, government never used to know, but then now government has put up a similar format for reporting and they can compare the data between companies and between industry to industry. So what has MCA done? MCA has released costing taxonomy 2015 for filing of cost audit report. It's a very important document. Of course, most of the data is technical also, but then you will have to sit and understand. Using the taxonomy, XBRL instance document is to be created. So taxonomy enables you to create the XBRL instance document in the software. Instance documents is to be filed with MCA. So what are you filing? From the taxonomy, you generate instance document. Instance document is to be filed with the MCA. Our institute has released a manual titled Architecture Training and Guidance Manual. I have already discussed that actually gives an end-to-end picture of the mode of preparing the annexures and mode of filing. It gives complete information. The manual is available at ICMI PD portal and MCA site. I have given the link also. Of course, you can check it, trace it from internet. So before filing the report, you will have to understand the costing taxonomy. Then business rules, MCA has released business rules fields. These are the rules for entering the data in the software. Then scope and level of tagging the data. Then filing manual issued by MCA. It also details validation. Validation means after entering the data, you will have to do a validation with the MCA software. What are the validation? Then pre-scrutiny, where all you have to do the pre-scrutiny, and what are the errors, common errors that can pop up. Everything is contained in the manual. Then there is an FAQ also on costing taxonomy 2015. So before filing XBRL, you understand all these things in detail. And I have already told page 40 to 80 for the architecture training manual gives a detailed para-wise, line item-wise information on how cost audit annexures are to be prepared. And it also tells you how to create the instance document. It is highly useful, and the students who are listening to this also, I would advise to go through this. It gives a very real clarity on any of the item which is contained in the annexure. Then first step is to prepare the annexures and report in Excel and Word format. Report in Excel and Word format. Always try to enter the figures in lakhs for convenience. If you enter the absolute figures and decimals, you will land up in errors when you do the validation. So the pop-up actually there is a facility for entering figures also, but then try to confine your reporting to lakhs. Then you can copy paste from the Excel in the software. Then general information details of cost auditor while you're entering. You should punch the name of the cost auditor in line with the MCA document. For example, my name is T.R. Balachandran, but my data in MCA records is Thekkadathu Ramanpillai Balachandran. So you will have to punch this name, Thekkadathu Ramanpillai Balachandran. Otherwise, at the time of validation, it will pop up. The name doesn't exist. That will come up. Then make sure that the partner or the proprietor whose name is getting entered had paid all the fees for COP and membership. Because if I am signing the report, I'll have to ensure that I have paid all the fee and the institute site. See, when you validate, this will also parallelly check with the institute site and ensure that the person who is filing the report has a valid certificate of practice. So unless you ensure that your fees is paid up and your membership is live, when you enter, try to file a cost audit report, errors will pop up. That report and cost audit policy, you can copy paste from the Word file. That product or service details, that I think is the part A, I think the fourth statement. It should, the income which is shown there should tally with the P&L account income. You should ensure that, otherwise errors will pop up. Then quantity information, quantity information which is part A, I think the fifth statement, quantity information, there is not rounding of facility. Quantity has to be entered as such. If decimals are there, you can enter decimals also. There is no rounding of facility for quantity info. Then average cost statement. Ensure that all the figures are punched correctly, because the figures can be punched correctly, but then totals are actually totaled by the system. So unless you enter all the figures correctly, when you validate it, the totals will pop up and you will find that this total is in variance with the Excel that you are having. So ensure that all the figures are punched correctly. For materials and utilities, there is a, if you go to the XBRL, for materials and utilities, there is a supporting information. For example, for material, it will ask quantity, it will ask rate, it will ask the consumption quantity, it will ask total value also. If there are 5 materials or 10 materials, all the major materials have to be listed, and other items you can classify others. Actually, the XBRL software takes the data from that supporting statement and puts it here. But then when you enter the utility also it asks for quantity. Quantity means how much power consumed, how much units, how many units. For example, for fuel, steam generation, what is the fuel consumed, what is the quantity. And suppose you don't have the quantity, for example, in service industry, you may not track it. I mean, I'm setting only hypothetical scenario. If you don't have the quantity, ensure that you punch a zero there. Otherwise, in validation, it will pop up an error. Then you also remember that there is a facility for capturing footnotes under each paragraph. So each of the paragraph, there is a facility for capturing footnote. For example, capacity. If there is a void variation previous year, you can give a note. The XBRL software gives a facility for entering that note. You can copy paste that note. Cost statement, how many, whatever may be the notes you have, there is a facility for copy paste those notes under the paragraph. Ensure this is, and as per the rules also, you are supposed to give all the reasons for all the major variations in cost or ratios or capacity. The related party is the only annexure where you will not find there is a facility for entering a footnote. So related party is the only paragraph where you will find that there is no facility for entering any footnote. So related party, normally we give a comment saying that this is as per the accounting standard so and so, and we are not considering detailed audit. That is our normal comment. So since there is no provision in the footnote, what you should do is, in the first audit report, in the observations, there is a place for first auditors observation suggestion. There you can give a note, this note relating to related party. Then entries in XBRL are to be validated using validation tool of MCA. Normally there is a validation tool of MCA. Normally it will be there along with the XBRL software, but make it sure that the validation tool is the latest one. So you'll have to download the latest validation tool from MCA side. If the validation tool is not latest, then when you validate, errors will pop up. So validation tool will also check the arithmetical accuracy in some cross tallying of figures like margins and revenue. Validation tool will do that. So remember, you have to, when you are filing in XBRL software, be sure that all the figures that you punch in are in line with Excel, because Excel has to be in line with P&L or reconciliation, whatever may be. So all the data has to be in line with that. In pre-scrutiny, MCA details like node use of the cost audit and name extra will be checked, which we already discussed. If you have a dues, if you are not renewed your certificate of practice, it will pop up in pre-scrutiny. After validation and pre-scrutiny, XML file can be created. So we are filing the XML file along in CRA4 is a format in which audit cost audit report has to be filed by the company. So XML file has to be attached to CRA 4. CRA 4 is to be generated by the company, XML, we have already discussed. Then always in CRA 4, it asks for the company, CA number of the company, then it will ask for pre-fill. Always use the pre-fill option while preparing the PRA 4 so that there is no mismatch with MCA details. When you pre-fill, it will pop up the data as per the MCA record. Then CRA 4 is suggested to be downloaded fresh from MCSA because CRA 4 also undergoes certain changes. If you are not downloading the latest form, you might come across with validation errors. Then if you are generating CRA 4 and sending to company by mail for filing, this year we had a specific problem. We created XML file, CRA 4 was also downloaded, the latest one, and we sent CRA 4 and XML file in separate in mails. But then repeatedly validation errors were coming. So finally we checked up the matter with the vendor. So he suggested that you send it in a zip file. CRA 4 as well as the XML file. When we sent it a zip file, it went through. So such type of errors might pop up. So for every error, understand, I'm coming to that. There is when you buy the software, try to buy it from the approved vendor of MCA so that you get a support for if there is any error while filing. Even small decimal difference will pop up as errors. For example, I am coming with some errors. In product service details, the total revenue should match with gross sale in value addition. The total revenue is here, the total revenue is given in value addition also. If it doesn't match, errors will pop up. Then profit as per profit, there is one just before reconciliation, there is a profitability statement which actually talks about the profit as per audited product. That has to match with the profit as per profitability statement should match exactly with profit as per cost records for audited products in the reconciliation. These two has to match, otherwise errors will come. Then ensure the quantity is not rounded off to that. Then related party, when you enter, you are supposed to enter permanent account number or CAN number. It should match with MCA records. So ensure that you check it before entering. If the PAN or CAN is not correct, when you do validation, it will fail. Then MCA has also released filing manual for costing taxonomy. Check this for clarity on XML creation, filing errors and solution. So this manual is highly useful. You can go to the MCA site and get this manual. In case of error, you are not able to solve, contact software partner for solution. I have already told. So always try to go by the preferred vendor of MCA. So if the vendor is not able to support, you can raise a ticket with MCA for the solution. They will support you. So download the latest validity we have already discussed. Then select XBRL vendor from MCA approved panel. Then in this filing manual for processing taxonomy, annexure 1 and 2 gives common validation errors and reasons and interpretation for common errors. So you can go through that. Once when you repeatedly do 3 or 4 filing, then many of the errors you will also become familiar and you will be automatic. And why XBRL? It provides the various cost elements industry-wise, which can be used by all stakeholders in policy making, projection, and projections in various reports. See, this link I will share with Trivandrum chapter. This is a link which you can refer. See, where actually the ministry has done industry level comparison of all the cost elements. This is a summarized report which is about 250 pages are there. So from the XBRL reports compiled by various companies, they have actually analyzed the cost structure of all the companies, and this report will show all the details. That is why I am saying, or rather we understand, that XBRL filing is an excellent tool to analyze the industry, and government has all the data available. Not only government, the taxation department has all the data available. These are the XBRL partners. This is downloaded from MCA site. Taxman is a preferred vendor. WebTel is a preferred vendor. So you can go through that. Then if at all, this is the last part of my presentation. There is a technical cell of Power Institute. If at all some of the queries, we have some queries resolved by the technical cell, It have been uploaded on the technical cell portal of the website of the institute for the information of the members and stakeholders. So any clarity on anything related to your storage analysis or XBRL filing, whatever queries they have rectified till date, it has been uploaded in the technical cell portal. You can go through that. If at all you encounter a problem, a similar problem somebody else have encountered earlier, and if it has been taken up with technical cell, the solution will be there. And compilation of 103 queries with explanations are available in the institute website. That is updated up to 29th July 2013 PDF format for easy reference. All the queries, whatever MCA, whatever our institute has rectified till date, it is available in a PDF format in the institute site. If at all you have any query related to anything like the XBRL filing or the annexures, all the queries are answered. You can get clarity from the technical cell portal. That's all from my side. Thank you. Thank you very much for patient hearing. So I am deeply, greatly thankful to the Trivandrum chapter for giving me an opportunity. It has been a very lengthy exercise because I don't normally fall in this. I don't know whether I can call it a trap because I am not a teacher. I said in the beginning itself, and I am an orator also. But then since Pranav calls me, Pranav is working with one of my clients. He forced me. I took up this opportunity and I really enjoyed it. And I must add one more thing. My capabilities, if at all, in costing and cost audit, my capabilities, I owe everything to my guru, Mr. N.P. Gopalakrishnan. I don't know how many of you heard that company is still in, name is still existent. It is now actually. His brother is at the chairing number of affairs. So Mr. Gopalakrishnan was my guru. I started my career with him, and he was an excellent cost accountant and an excellent cost auditor. And he was probably a pioneer of the profession, pioneer of the cost, a pioneer of the profession itself in South India, because he started practice as early as in 1973, when he was working in a plum post in a public sector. On some difference in opinion with the manager, he threw off his job and started practice. Those days it was just getting developed only, but then his analytical skills, his ability to convince the client, his ability to argue, his ability to understand the subject was superb, and I have gained under him, and I must thank my capabilities to him. Thank you so much, Trivandrum chapter, for giving me an opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Sir, it's a very good. Hello, audible? It's audible, sir?
Yeah, audible, audible.
Audible, yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving us a very good presentation and the ending report. And in this moment, I welcome our the Pushpakumar sir, our CAT committee chairman, to say a few words on that.
Before that, I just forgot. Was there any question? I forgot.
Okay. If there is any question, audience.
Okay, tell me. Yeah, tell me. Yeah.
Hello.
Okay,
is there any question? Yeah, Kekam.
No, we didn't receive any question from the audience.
Dear Simi Balendraji, you have explained about the multiple products a company will be having, and the cost audit per you will be coming to a certain extent of products. And you told that it is not mandatory, but compulsory. We need to make a separate item wise, product wise cost sheet. And we have to show only the cost related to the cost audit report in that. And the other thing, what way the other not covered under this audit, how it is to be explained elsewhere.
Okay. See, as an auditor, see, if you see, in most of the companies, in some companies I have seen, let's say 80-90% of the products are covered under cost audit, but 10% is not covered. What to do? But then when you compile the cost sheet, you will have to segregate the cost to all the cost centers, you will have to segregate the cost to all the products. So you are under not even though not under compulsion, you will be compiling the cost statement for all the products.
Correct.
And when you disclose it, you will give when in the final profitability statement, reconciliation statement, you will show profit or margin on products under cost audit, profit or margin on products not under cost audit. But then theoretically for the company the data is available, and it is ideal for you also to calculate that individually, because while giving the management report you can actually point this aspect. I mean, if there is any anomaly or if there is any margin issues in those old products which are not under audit, you can point it out. That's why I'm saying it is, but anyway you are doing 80-90% job, so why not complete the exercise for all the other products, because you have to segregate the cost, you have no choice. Otherwise, there are certain industries where, let's say, we have one client where they are into manufacturing and service. So they have three verticals which are in the manufacturing and two verticals which are in the service. So what we do is, there actually manufacturing completely we do. Even though some of the products are not covered under cost audit, manufacturing completely we do. But service we exclude. But service means they have logistics and they have travel. Service we exclude and pull up under products not under audit. But then manufacturing we completely do, out of which products under audit we will show separately and products not under audit we will show separately.
That will be shown the profitability reconciliation.
Reconciliation, yeah, correct.
Okay, thanks.
Thank okay, you. Now I welcome Pushpamar sir for giving some viewpoints on that.
Thank you, Ajit Kumar.
Thank you, sir.
CMATR Ramendran, yes. Balachandran, guest speaker. Our chairman, Pramod Chandran sir, secretary Pranav ji, PD committee chairman Ajit sir, other members who are watching this. Good evening to all. And here, I am very much thankful to Mr. CMA Balachandran. He was telling that he is not a teacher or an orator, but it is proved to be a real mentor and advisor to give a very good lecture on this particular topic. All the three sessions were very much elaborative, illustrative, to have a great understanding on the cost audit mechanism, audit process in general, and audit of the manufacturing and service sector. And also to recap all of us, for the students appearing for the examination, have grasped till this webinar session. It had also a lot of learning points with new additional points and latest notifications issued by the concerned ministry. It is very much useful for all of us. We remain very much obliged to you. Our words may not be capable of communicating our obligation and gratitude.
Thank you,
Sami Damendran, Balachandran. And I was having a very good relationship with him for the last 40 years. And as he explained, he was with CMA Gopalakrishnan ji. I am also having very good rapport and nearness with Gopalakrishnan ji. Of course, with that, as a consultant, our Balachandran ji also a part of consultant for doing some work where I was working as a finance manager of one of the organization in Kerala. And those time also I was keeping a watch on CMA Balachandran, because he has been getting a very good guidance from a very big leader, a big consultant like Gopalakrishnan. He is a elder brother of MB Sumaran sir. Anyway, thank you very much, Ranji. We will always remember you, and we promise we never forget you on this particular topic. This much elaborations. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Pushpamar sir. Thank you. Now we will come to an end of the program. This is word of thanks, and it's my duty to say what a few words on word of thanks. Firstly, I would like to thank our chairman Pramod Chandran sir for bringing this program continuously, and a very nice program. It's very much interested in our members and students. And secondly, I would like to thank our Padmanabhan sir. Without him, this program cannot be scheduled and the broadcasted. And thank you, Padmanabhan sir, for this event. Another, I would like to thank the Secretary Pranav and our managing committee members like Prashwamar sir, Nisha, our Louis sir, Prashant, Vishnu, and everybody who supported for conducting this program very nicely. And one more thing, I have to the third one, I have to thank the number one. I have to thank our Balachandran sir for giving a wonderful speech on the training session of cost audit. You know, the starting time, I couldn't get into the program myself, and the Pushma sir and myself, I couldn't get into the program. After half an hour, we get into the program and we watched nicely and very much expressed, as Pushpa Kumar sir told, it nicely presented and it gone to each and every aspects of cost audit. I think he nicely he touched almost all the areas of cost audit and deeply. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Balendra sir, for giving very good program. Thus, we come to a very wonderful third session, and 1, 2, 3, third session of continuous program of cost audit. It's one of the best and I ever had in during my tenure in Trivandrum DCCA. Sir, very nicely presented, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And we are expecting some more programs from your side. And really, it's a nice one. I already last time, thank you, sir. And nicely, I already talked to you last time that we already got so many, you know, inquiries from outside. Who is Balachandran sir and how you selected, sir, for this program? Because so many chapters, they are asking for a presenter on cost audit, they are not getting. This is the, I think, some of the negative elements that we don't have much trainer on cost audit. So we are continuously trying to improve our session on cost audit. This is our core area to members and students. This is our main aim. And like this, the next week we are starting with the companies, filing and companies, company registration and other also. We are conducting so many programs. And I would like to thank closely the members and our students who participated in and watched the programs. Even our members also, other professionals also watched the program very nicely, sir. Thank you for being with us. And without them, the support and everything, we couldn't conduct the program. So nicely, I expect everybody's suggestions and support to conduct more and more program on this event, sir. And last but not least, I would like to thank our technical staff, Jaya Madam, Goban Ji, and all other office staff for conducting this session very nicely, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Now I will share anthem. Anthem idaiya. ഓഡിയോ മറ്റേ ഓഡിയോ ആയില്ല അതെങ്ങനെ എടുക്കാൻ പറ്റില്ല ഓഡിയോ എടുക്കാൻ പറ്റില്ല ഓഡിയോ സ്റ്റോപ്പ് ഷെയർ ഓഡിയോ
अस्तु मा सद्गमय तमसु मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मामृतं गमय मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्युर्मामृतं गमय असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्युर्मामृतं गमय ॐ शांति शांति शांति
थैंक यू वेरी मच
थैंक यू सर थैंक यू फॉर ऑल थैंक यू
या
എന്ത് ചെയ്തേക്കാം അല്ലേ എന്ത് ചെയ്തേക്കാം